Hi, my name is Zachary Boyd. I'm a wealth builder and financial planner, and this video is a Transamerica insurance review, more specifically a review of the Financial Foundation Index Universal Life, or IUL for short. So the Financial Foundation IUL by Transamerica. So I'm going to dig into the pros and the cons, what's good, what's not good about this product. I am not getting into whether or not an IUL is good or bad, because that totally depends on the company and the design, but this is more specifically on the product. Now, I do have a little bit of an issue of the people promoting Transamerica's IUL, and it's usually, you probably heard this from a WFG agent or World Financial Group, that sort, and I do also have an issue, which I'll explain near the end of this video. But I want to dig into the pros and cons of specifically of this product. So let's dig in. So let's talk about the good, because we got to give it credit where credit's due. They do have strong financial ratings. So if we want to look at the Comdex ratings, which is usually a compilation of all the four review companies, so they all tend to give a lot of A's out there. So where do they really fall in comparison to the other companies? And I talk about the disparity of rating companies in my report, the 6 Things Agents Don't Tell You About Index Universal Life, and feel free to download that report too. But Comdex at least gives you a bearing of where it falls in comparison to other companies. So the Comdex level on the Transamerica is pretty strong. It's very high, it's a very good financial rating. So you see the Transamerica Life Insurance gets A's across the board, so like everybody gets A's. They get a 91. And you can see even further down, everybody still gets A's, but they're at 77. So the Comdex score really siphons out who the higher A's versus the lower A's, right? So that's a good thing. So good on them. They're a strong financial company. Nothing wrong with them financially. So another positive about Transamerica's IUL is that they include now the chronic and critical illness riders, and I think in all states now, maybe one or two that don't, but that is a huge benefit. So how chronic or living benefits work is, instead of just you dying to get the death benefit, how morbid that is, right? But you also get benefits of that death benefit, a portion of that death benefit, in the event that you're chronically ill, which means 2 activities of daily living that you can no longer do and you can access the death benefit, or if you had like a heart attack, stroke, cancer, something along those lines, you can access the death benefit through a living benefit such as a chronic or critical illness. All right, so that's good. The next thing is good about them. They do have higher than average caps. If you look at caps of Transamerica versus, I'm talking about their index caps. So their S&P 500 is their S&P 500 is at like 13.75, I believe, which is really competitive. But I really like one of their funds here. It's called the index account. It's a global index fund. And it's, so it's a blended weighted average between 50% of the S&P 500, which is 500 of the biggest American companies, the U.S. companies. But it also has 30% in the Euro stock index and 20% in the Hang Seng index. And this has a 15% cap. So you get a good amount of growth potential with this cap at 15%. So not bad. Let's talk about the red flags. All right. So red flag number one, it is actually one of the most expensive IULs on the market. So if you would do a breakdown, if you ever do an illustration of the numbers, get the breakdown of the fees. Now, I actually had a hard time getting this from somebody. They sent me one of the most complicated fee breakdowns that I've seen. And you had to basically take a calculator. And even if you knew how to calculate it, you basically had to be an insurance mortality table expert to figure out what actually the fees were. But I finally got a clear fee chart, and the fee breakdown is very high compared to most other index universal lives. So that's huge. So it's getting high performance, but it's also costing you a lot to get that performance. And I'm gonna talk about whether or not that's a good thing. The next red flag is they add a 0.72 annual index fee on that's charged 0.06 monthly to your account. So usually you're credited on your index accounts point to point, which is year to year. So every year it's compounding, only on an annual basis. But this charge is happening incrementally every month throughout that whole year. Don't like that. And they don't give you the option. Some companies have this asset fee on just maybe one or two indexes. Maybe they're super high performing, no cap option. This has it on even the S&P 500. No matter what you get, you're going to get a 0.72 asset fee. And what's really like strange is it's not on the illustration, at least the one I just recently got. You don't see an index asset fee anywhere. I even talked to one of their so-called wholesalers and he couldn't find it either. Okay, it's not on the illustration, but I do see it on the brochure. 0.06 or 0.72 annually, taking on the monthly policy date through age 20, prorated by account value, then prorated across segments within each account. So it's there and it's being calculated, but it doesn't, you don't get any notice of it in the illustration, which seems a little sketch to me. So the next thing let's talk about, it is only the 25th best performer on a cash value basis, basically taking income and giving cash value over a period of time. It is the 25th best performer. So now we get into the nuts and bolts of this. So if it is the third most expensive, you'd think it would be the third best performer, one of the top performers. If I'm paying a lot in fees, because what they're doing is they're buying more options. With those fees that they're taking. And so you think that would be better performance or at least better potential. There is a little bit better potential, but overall it's shown that the performance of this is very mediocre, if not on the bottom portion of the list. There's about 40 big top players, IUL, Index Universal Life, insurance carriers out there. I wouldn't say all of them are top here, but there's about 40 that are pretty well known. And to be 25th and be the third most expensive and 25th best performer, not really getting a good bang for your buck, in my opinion. But the big deal breaker for me when a company happens is this, is when they have a history of raising policy costs on previously issued policies. This is huge. That means I can't trust you. Can you entrust any insurance company or any firm that, you know, once you become a client, you're a customer? And that's the thing with insurance is different from investments. Investments, I can just pull it out and switch it anytime I want to. It doesn't matter on age, health, or whatever. But with insurance, you're investing all these dollars. You got surrender charges. It's a bit more of a, like a marriage, right? Because once you get locked in, right, you're locking in your health. And if you invest, you're investing your health sometimes as just as big of an investment as your money. You get invested with this company 20 years from now, you can't, and they change the cost of this, you might not be able to qualify for another company. Or if so, it's super much more expensive, right? So that just puts you in a bad position. So picking the right company that you're gonna invest your health with and your dollars, you wanna get the right one. Hardly any of them change their fees. And I know this is the big objection whole life people have of Index Universal Life or people that it's just a big objection is that they can change the fees at any time. Yes, they can. They have to have some leeway because there's a lot of levers in Index Universal Life. But what that is, but most of the big players do not do this, okay? They do not change the fees as long as they're 100-year-old companies. So that's huge. So deal breaker number two. Right? So they got two deal breakers, not just one, they got two deal breakers. That's rough, right? No variable loans. You gotta be kidding me. There's no variable loans in this IUL. Okay, so let me tell you a little bit of something. And we're gonna dig into why variable loans is so huge in this video. But variable loans is probably the biggest feature outside of the tax advantage money growth and the fact that you can't lose money. Outside of those two things, I would say variable loans is a huge third or right up there with the top two of those categories, right? If you don't have variable loans, I wouldn't do an Index Universal Life. I'd go do whole life. I'd go do something else. Variable loans, once I explain it to you, you'll see how big of an advantage and a benefit that is to you by having variable loan policy. Okay, so let's dig in how variable loans work, because some of you are like, well, I don't really care about variable loans. What's that mean? What, you know, and I understand. So we're going to dig in and explain exactly what is a variable loan. All right, so I'm going to use the analogy of real estate so you can kind of get it. So if you have a home or invest in real estate, this is really going to help you out to understand variable loan and versus policy account value. So in this example, I'm going to say there's a house worth $500,000. Now, many of you are thinking like, well, what kind of house are we talking about, Zach? If you're using the Midwest, the $500,000 could buy a mansion. Well, here in California, it just buys you a normal home. So I live in California, so yeah, the $500,000 home is a normal home here. So $500,000, I'm gonna assume that this house is paid off for this example, meaning your equity is equal to the value. So you have $500,000 valued home and $500,000 in equity. It's paid off, all right? So let's say you take a home equity line of credit, that is a HELOC, for $100,000. If you have a house worth $500,000 minus the loan, the HELOC that you have outstanding, you wanna do some improvements, upgrade it, maybe you wanna sell it, whatever. Is it now then worth only $400,000, right? What is it worth $400,000 if you take a loan out? Well, no, of course it isn't, right? It's not worth, it's still worth $500,000, right? So, and smiley face, right? Smile, like it's worth $500,000. I got a loan against it. I'm collateralizing my equity, right? But I still, my value is still working at that value of $500,000. So let's assume this house appreciates at 35% after 5 years. So again, this $500,000 is growing about average 7%. So over 5 years, it's 35%. It would be worth about $675,000, okay? Versus the other example, if your house then was reduced by $100,000, only had $400,000 value, then again, that would only be worth $540,000. So this is how investments work. Investments work like the $400,000 example. And insurance or IULs that don't have a variable loan rate or whole life to have direct recognition loads all work the same way. They don't have this benefit where they see value and equity disparity. So let's say you have a 400,000 home that 100,000 is taken away from the value of your home, so you only have 400,000 working for you. You get an average of 7% appreciation or value on increase on it, you'll have 35% after 5 years, you have 440,000. Let's say you have a fixed loan out. So with Index Universal Life, you can get a fixed loan, be about 1% or 2% for the first 10 years. It's usually 0%, it's a wash loan. You after like 10 years in most companies, some companies a little different. So let's just say it's a negative 1% charge. If you got a regular HELOC, it'd be a lot more. And if you withdraw investments out of your retirement account or savings account, it would only, it would be no charge, right? You'd be just withdrawal, but you might have to pay penalties or taxes. So there is some fees usually withdrawing money out of a qualified account. So let's say it's charging a negative 1% for the next 5 years, so negative 5%, so minus $5,000. If I go to sell this house, then my equity value, my sell value is $535,000. Now, if we take an example of real estate, Index Universal Life, or IUL with variable loan rates, or non-direct recognition loan, I know that's a long word, non-direct recognition loans on whole life, now you get what's called like an arbitrage. So if you had a house worth $500,000, grew by 35% over 5 years, be worth $675,000, we got that. Take a HELOC out, home equity line of credit, or a variable loan in an Index Universal Life product or a non-direct recognition loan in and whole life. Let's say it's an IUL, you're getting charged about 4% right now on your loans in Index Universal Life. HELOC for a real estate would be probably a little bit more than that. So let's say over the next 5 years, that's a net total of negative 20. So that would be 120,000. So if you were to sell this home, you'd get the value minus the loan and what you've charged on it for the 5 years, okay? So your sell value would be 555,000. And so the difference is 555 versus 535, or an equity difference of $20,000 over that 5 years. Now, that doesn't seem like a lot, but as we expand the years, that gap widens quite a bit. So let me show you a bigger example. So my question is, would you rather have 7% annual appreciation applied to $535,000 a year or $675,000 a year going forward? That's the huge difference between variable loan, Index Universal Life, non-variable loans, And same thing for direct recognition, whole life, non-direct recognition, whole life. This shows the power of interest applied to value versus equity. Because most investments, once you pull out the money, you've lost the value too. You pull out $500,000, you pull out $100,000, it's now only worth $400,000. But with an index universal life, whole life withdrawn non-direct recognition loans, you're getting that difference. You're still getting interest credited on that value, just like a house. So let's look at two examples of variable loans. There's a good example and then there's a bad example. So I'm going to show you the pros and cons of variable loans. This doesn't necessarily apply to whole life because whole life, it's more consistent. It's every year you're always going to get a positive arbitrage. So let's dig in. Let's highlight that $100,000 that you had that it's earning you 7% or $7,000 a year. Right? And every year, your home equity line of credit that you loan, you're getting charged because you're collateralizing that $100,000 to get that loan. Now remember, not all debt is bad. If you ever read Robert Kiyosaki's book, there is a such thing as good debt, bad debt. Companies all the time use debt on their books. Look at Google, look at Amazon. Massive companies that are super profitable still have debt on the books because they're leveraging that debt. So if we see in this example, that's that $100,000 minus the charge that year. So that year you got 7% gain on that value minus the charge against that, you end up with a positive net or a positive arbitrage situation of 3% or $3,000. Now the risk, or as the naysayers would point out, well, what if the market goes backwards and you're getting charged? Well, that can happen. So let's say you, on your variable loan rate, on that $100,000, you got no gain. Now remember, an index universal life, you can never have a negative year. That's one really positive thing in the savings account of index universal life. But you're still gonna get charged at that 4%. So you could see how, you know, in the worst case scenario, you're gonna get negative plus the charge, you're gonna get a zero plus the charge, and it's gonna go worse. Now, in a home real estate example, you could be a negative, right? Because the home value could actually lose value. In this case, you could compound on top of that negative 4%. But in an index universal life, it's always good, worst case scenario is always gonna be a zero that given year. Minus the 4% or whatever the rate is at that year would be $4,000 in this example, minus $4,000, be a net of $4,000. So you're like, oh, well, I could go backwards by four. Yes, you could. And that is the risk of variable loans. And so now the question is, you know, how does the market, does the market normally go up and go back? If you look at the market, S&P 500, and you look at the years, and out of the history of the stock market, on 10 years on average, there's usually 7 up years, right? And then there's 3 down years. So in most cases, the variable loan is going to be advantageous. Why? Because most of the time the market's going up. So you're getting positive arbitrage. You're getting a positive equity view. So let's dig in a little bit deeper on a bigger number example. Let's say you have your money in 401k, 403b, regular investment. It's in stocks, not in an IUL whole life. But no variable loan or an IUL with no variable loan or a direct recognition loan company, a whole life company. If you had $2 million and you withdrew $1 million, guess what? You now only have $1 million working for you. That's it. So $1 million, if you got an average of 7% a year, right, that would be $70,000 that year net. But if you have a regular, how real estate works, or index universal life with variable loans or non-direct recognition loans in whole life. So long. They need to come up with a shorter word for explaining that. Then $2 million, if you had $2 million and you collateralized that $2 million, so if you have $2 million and you collateralize that $2 million with a loan of $1 million, it's not a withdrawal, okay? So in that case, you're still getting credit or interest credits based on the full $2 million. So in this case, 7% on $2 million is now $140,000, not 70, minus the charge for the loan. So in this case, it's at 4%, so it would be $40,000 loan charge. Then we would have a positive net of $100,000. So now let's look at $70,000 versus $100,000. That's a 42.8% difference more than $70,000, right? I've seen index universal policies where there's like $4 million in account value versus only $300,000 or $400,000 in equity. And so you can imagine getting credit of 7% on $4 million versus 7% on $300,000 or $400,000 or $500,000. It makes a huge difference to get credit on the value, not the equity, and then just subtract the charge for the outstanding loans. In most cases, in the long term, you're going to end up on top if you do it in the long run. So I ran an illustration for Transamerica, and I compared it to one of the cheapest index universal life out there. So I ran it at a male age 40, standard rating, contributes at $12,000 a year for the next 25 years. So that would be to age 65. That would be a net of $300,000 contribution over those 25 years. So with the Transamerica Financial Foundation Index Universal Life, or IUL, is illustrated at 7.75 as their max illustrated rate, so you can't illustrate it any higher. And the total cash flow from age 66 through 100 would have been a grand total of $1,543,955. Okay, I think it was like around $44,000 a year for those 35 years. So not bad, that's a good chunk. You put in 300,000 and over your lifetime you get 1.5. So that's gonna show you the power of IUL. Now this IUL is designed optimally as it could be, even with an inferior product that I believe Transamerica's IUL is. So we compare it to one of the top three cheapest IUL. I'm not gonna put the name on there because I'm not just making an endorsement for this company. I think there's actually a couple companies that are actually better than this company, but it is one of the cheapest ones. So I'm just gonna use it in comparison. So I illustrated this company at only 6%. I think their illustration rate is quite a bit higher for their max, but I just wanted to really show you guys the differences in how the fees and the variable loans rates affecting the cash flow of the Transamerica IUL. So illustrated at only 6%, total cash flow, same difference, 35 years. So the cash flow generated from this cheap IUL was $1,695,365. So, and then again, the illustration rate is a big disparity here, huge disparity. So that's actually a 29% difference in illustration rate. So even though the Transamerica IUL is illustrated at 29% higher illustration because of the higher caps and all that stuff, so it gets a higher potential, it's still getting 9.8% cash flow. So you think it would be all things equal, it definitely outperform because it's charging more. But even though because it's charging more, because of the fact it is one of the most expensive index universal life policies in the market, combine that with the fact that there's no variable loan option with the policy, you get a policy that does really, that performs really poorly for cash flow purposes, which is the reason why you would design an IUL in the first place. Because of the design of variable loans inside of a policy, it allows you to pull out usually more cash on a consistent basis over the period of your lifetime than a traditional investment or an index universal life that doesn't have variable loans. So let's talk about the Transamerica Index Universal Life in summary. So the pros, again, the company rating is really strong. Nothing against it. Matter of fact, their term, I think insurance is really good. I don't have a knock against their other product. I haven't reviewed it. So their term's probably fine if you just want to get a term policy from them. Company financial rating's good. Which is why it's so surprising is that their performance and they're changing their fees on policy owners. So that's really interesting. High caps, 13.75 in S&P 500, 15% on the global. They have really good living benefits. But the cons is it's the third most expensive IUL. You have to have good performance because if you don't, your policy is going to get eaten away with the fees inside of it. That's the problem with this policy. And that asset charge, I mean, you're gonna get tacked on top of that cap, so you might as well reduce that cap by 0.75, 0.72 on each, on all the caps, because you're getting charged this asset fee. It's up the ass. It is an ass fee. Anyway, asset fee, yeah. So it is an asset fee that's gonna get charged every year, right? And it's actually charged on a monthly basis. Altering issued policy costs, that's my deal breaker. Sad face. Get away. Get away. No variable loan option. Oh my God. How do you? 25th best cash flow, 25th best in cash flow performance. Again, why are you so expensive? Like, I expect more performance, but it's not there. I'm not even going to give this a little, I do not recommend this product conclusion. I'm giving this a go run the other way. When you see this coming at you, when you see a WFG, World Financial Group agent running at your door, trying to pitch to you an index universal life from Transamerica, just tell no thank you. I will pass. So to make matters worse, on top of the fact that the product, that the IUL by Transamerica is a subpar product in my opinion in comparison to the many other IULs that are out there, is the fact that you have agents that are trying to sell this IUL. Okay, well, here's the problem. With Index Universal Life, because there are a lot of moving parts and it's a very complex financial tool and can be great if they're designed right, well, the problem and probably the biggest problem I see out there, even with good companies, is agents that don't design them right. They don't know how to drive the race car, right? So anybody can get a license. So it's like any car driver, you know, anybody can get a driver's license to drive a car. Anybody can get an insurance license, right? It's almost the same analogy, but not everybody can drive a race car. And it requires a race car driver, it requires experience and somebody that knows what they're doing to set these up. Well, guess what? The agents that are coming from World Financial Group or WFG, guess what? They have no idea, first of all, that their product is inferior, right? They just look at the caps. They see the things that are on the front parts of the brochure. It looks pretty and nice until you get in under the hood and know how to look at an engine and drive a real car, right? Until you look under it and you see, okay, oh, the fees are way more. Oh, the cash performance is really not that good. And why? Why is that? Why variable loans? What is that? Most of them have no idea. I would highly recommend somebody who knows how these products work to take a look at what you're trying to do. It may not even make sense to do an IUL. I mean, an index universal life for a whole life policy can make a lot of sense for a lot of people, but the design could be flawed. It isn't a one size fits all shoe, right? If you have a size 12, then we're gonna try to get a shoe to fit the size 12. If you're a size 7, then we're gonna try to fit it over here in the size 7 category. Well, that what's happening with these agents is they're designing a one-size-fits-all product and they're selling to everybody. And another thing to add, they're selling these based on the commission that they would make. So they're designing with high commissions, with high death benefit, more than you need. Especially if they're trying to do it for cash flow, it's going to be inferior cash flow design. And so it's not going to perform the way you want it because they're designing it so they can get more commission from them because they're getting paid based on the amount of death benefit they sell, not on the cash flow they give you. So you want somebody that's looking out for you and for your best benefit. So if you'd like me to review your policy, please click on the link below, fill out that contact form, and I'll be happy to set up an appointment. We'll review it. Another thing is that you want to do is download my free report, the 6 hard facts that agents don't tell you about Index Universal Life. I talk about a couple of things in my review today, but if you want to have kind of like the 6 things to look out for with an index before purchasing Index Universal Life, get that report. Download it below, it will require your name and email, and I'll send that report off to you. And last but not least, please, if you liked this video and if you found it helpful for you and you want me to do more reviews of Index Universal Life, Whole Life, whatever it is, more content, please like, subscribe below, and you'll get notified and I'll make more content. Thank you. Thanks for watching and have a great day.